This is The Allusionist, in which I, Helen Zaltzman, award language 12 points. This is the second half of our two-part excursion into the language of the Eurovision Song Contest, whose bespangled, all-singing, some-dancing surface belies the linguistic squabbles, politicking and upsets beneath. You don't even have to have seen the contest before for this podcast to be a worthwhile use of your time, but do treat yourself to some online clips of the Eurovisionary greats. The final of the 2023 contest is May 13th, and why don't you watch it with me and your fellow Illusionauts? We'll be gathered in the Illusionverse Discord to chat throughout, and it'll be lovely to have you along. Join us at theillusionist.org/donate. On with the show. Previously on the Eurovision Illusionist. In 1956, the European Broadcasting Union, or EBU, a body made up of state broadcasters of various different European countries, started the annual televisual event, the Eurovision Song Contest, in which each competing country performs an original song. And the rules have changed many times. Countries had to perform in one of their official national languages, then countries could perform in any language, then too many were choosing English, so the rule was restored that countries had to perform in their official national languages, then English language songs kept winning in the 1990s, so the compulsory national language rule was taken away again, and now countries can perform in whichever language they like. But that is still often English.
It's very interesting to see what they chose in the past and what they choose now.
Was it a disadvantage if you only had one national language, like less choice?
I wouldn't say it was a disadvantage. I would say that countries which have multiple national languages, such as Switzerland and Belgium, they would tend to go for the Romance languages, so Italian and French in their cases. But we can see that in recent years, these countries have tended to go for English as sort of a compromise language among the different national groups.
As in Eurovision Allusionist Part 1, we are joined by historian Dean Vuletic, author of Postwar Europe and the Eurovision Song Contest, the world's first scholarly study on the history of the Eurovision Song Contest. The choice of which national language to use if you had multiple could be very politically heated.
Definitely. When we look at a country like Yugoslavia, which had Serbo-Croatian, Slovenian and Macedonian as its official languages, generally, the variant that was opted for was Serbo-Croatian, and especially its Croatian standard, because that was the center of the popular music industry in Yugoslavia. Albanian, for example, even though it was the main language in Kosovo and was represented in Yugoslavia's national selections for Eurovision, never managed to make it through, nor did Macedonian, even though Macedonian was an official language of Yugoslavia at the time. So there was a lot of political controversy surrounding the domination of Croatian entries in the 1980s, especially when the federation began to disintegrate in the early 1990s. And in 1992, there were accusations made against the government of Slobodan Milosevic that it had rigged Yugoslavia's national selection in order to ensure the win of a Serbian singer, with the Serbian side responding that Croatian entries had dominated Yugoslavia's representation in Eurovision for so long that it was time for a Serbian entry to participate, and an entry, of course, in the Serbian variant of what was known then as the Serbo-Croatian language. So there were a lot of political controversies. And also in the 1980s in Yugoslavia, one of the key arguments of the movement in Slovenia, which eventually led to it becoming independent from Yugoslavia, was that the Slovenian language was in an inferior position regarding Serbo-Croatian, even though it was an official language in Yugoslavia, so that Serbo-Croatian was too dominant in the federation. And this was also evident in Yugoslavia's Eurovision entries, where, you know, the Slovenes really were marginalized. So, yes, the linguistic politics in these federations certainly also did have an effect on their Eurovision entries. There are lots of economic cultural and political factors that can decide which language will be most represented in a country's entries, even when it has various national languages.
Azerbaijan, the only country never to have entered in its national language.
Correct.
Could be this year.
I doubt it, because the Azerbaijani government has been very ambitious in Azerbaijan's Eurovision entries, in using them as a tool of soft power and cultural diplomacy. It has spent a lot of money in getting well-known songwriters and composers from across Europe to produce pop hits that could really win Eurovision. And of course, this means hits in English. And once Azerbaijan did win Eurovision in 2011 and went on to host the most expensive Eurovision ever in Baku. So Eurovision is also popular among dictators as a tool of cultural diplomacy, or as a tool for whitewashing their human rights and democratic records.
Excuse the gear shift. I could not think of a way to segue from dictatorships to this. I think quite a lot of people associate with Eurovision songs with nonsensical titles like Boom Bang A Bang, Diggy Loo Diggy Lay, and Ding A Dong and La La La, all of which have won. Is there an advantage to that because those titles transcend all languages in a way?
Of course, and that's why they were created. They were created to attract an international audience, to appeal to an international audience, and also to be sung by an international audience. So these songs emerged in the 1960s, the 1970s. Then they were especially popular at a time when Europop was at its height, when people were singing these songs across Europe in discos, holiday resorts, shopping centers, in all of these symbols of Western European prosperity. So this was also about being commercial. It was also about selling songs in these locations where Europeans from different countries would come together to holiday, to party, enjoy life. And that was also a time in the 1960s, 1970s, when we had several songs in Eurovision about going on holiday, usually sung by Northern Europeans going to the South. Southern Europeans never sang about going to Northern Europe and having a holiday there and falling in love, whereas Northern Europeans often did.
Aww.
As another fun fact, Helen, when it comes to the actual words that are used in Eurovision entries or the subjects of Eurovision entries, technological words, satellites, videos, planes, they would appear in Northern European entries, but they were never in Southern European entries. So that's a very interesting distinction, that Northern Europeans were more eager to sing about technology than Southern Europeans ever were.
Huh, wonder why.
Do I need to answer that question in a diplomatic way?
Yeah.
Well, we know the differences between the North and the South of Europe. The cultural differences, the economic differences. I think it is all related to that. For the South, songs, especially then, were about love. They were about nature. Let's say a more romantic notion of what popular music should be, and especially inspired by the Mediterranean sphere, this shared romantic Mediterranean cultural sphere, which Northern Europeans were also attracted to and discovering en masse in the early post-war decades, as Western Europe generally became a more prosperous place, as holidays became a right for workers. This was an area that Western Europe was really basking in and falling in love with. And when it comes to Northern Europe, let's say Northern Europe was the place of economic growth. It was the place where Southerners emigrated to work. It provided the opportunities to become prosperous.
Yeah. I mean, do you want to go somewhere warm and fall in love, or do you want to be prosperous? Those are the choices.
Or you do both. You be prosperous, and then, you know, you come back to the South for your holidays. Look, this is still the case in Europe today. We have this issue where so many young people are leaving the southern European countries to go and work in the more prosperous northern ones. But then where does everyone go for holiday in the summers? And the southern European economies are still very dependent on their tourism earnings. So this is something that has probably, I would say, become even more apparent since the 1960s and 1970s.
Technology references are allowed, but mentions of specific brands are not. In 2012, San Marino faced disqualification because their entry was called Facebook Uh-Oh-Oh, a satirical song. They renamed it the social network song Uh-Oh-Uh-Oh-Oh, but still got knocked out of the contest in the semi-finals. And in 2014, Belarus rewrote their song Cheesecake, replacing lyrics about Google Maps with All the Maps. Had they not learned the EBU's stance on brands already? Back in 1987, Sweden's entry had to be renamed Boogaloo, as the song's original title referenced Coca-Cola and the Swedish chewing gum brand Bug. Are there any other guidelines for what's allowed? Like, is there a style guide for the songs? Are there any words that are forbidden?
Of course, you can't have offensive words, swear words. Entries also should not have political messages, but what that actually means is controversial. So you can have a song, let's say, that promotes LGBT IQ issues, which, you know, in a lot of European countries isn't a problem, but in some European countries still is, unfortunately, and, you know, tragically. But that is something that the European Broadcasting Union would allow. But 2 years ago, the Belarusian entry that was submitted was performed by a group which appeared to be criticizing in its song the anti-government protesters in Belarus. And that song was disqualified because it was claimed by opposition groups in Belarus that the song was actually a political tool by the regime of Alexander Lukashenko to mock the protesters. And of course, Belarusian television is controlled by the government, the Belarusian member of the EBU. So the connection with the government was quite obvious. And after that, Belarus was actually disqualified from Eurovision, also from the EBU completely, because of the government's control over the television station.
We're just going to take a quick break for some ads. The Allusionist is sponsored by Bombas, makers of soft, breathable t-shirts that keep you from overheating, underwear made to move with you, and socks that are sweat-wicking, friction-free and anti-blister, so they're ready to join you on all of your action adventures. In fact, Bombas's athletic socks, which are available in a range of lengths, colours and patterns, are even designed so that one is specifically for your left foot and one for your right foot. Which sounds so obvious now that I say it. A foot isn't a symmetrical meat slab. Our shoes aren't boats you can wear on either foot. So why would our socks be? And if you happen to lose one, contact Bombas's customer happiness team as they may be able to furnish you with a replacement. I've mentioned to you before Bombas's happiness guarantee, but it is easier for a company to promise these things than deliver them. So I was very glad to hear from Palusionist Rosalie that when she received some socks with a little flaw in them, Bombas not only replaced them, but included extra socks too. Go to bombas.com/allusionist and use the code allusionist for 20% off your first purchase. That's bombas.com/allusionist and use the code allusionist at checkout. The Allusionist is sponsored by Kitsch. Care for your hair and skin. They've got shampoo and conditioner bars, eye masks, face rollers, sleep bonnets. My attention was immediately caught by their product, which looks like an extra long hot dog made of satin to entwine in your hair. It's actually Kitsch's heatless satin curling rollers, the original and best heatless curlers, creating curls without the heat damage because they're heatless, as aforementioned. Would love to try that. I really want to wear a satin hot dog crown, but my hair is already curly and too short. Instead, I've ordered one of Kitsch's satin pillowcases. I sleep on my face, so many days I wake up and my face looks like a jigsaw puzzle of my face that has been incorrectly assembled and left out in the rain. And for a long time I've heard that what is great for preventing rain-soaked puzzle face syndrome is satin pillowcases. Not to wear over your head to hide your sleep-mangled facescape, but to reduce friction on your face. And your hair too, stops your hair looking like pranksters rubbed your head with 100 miniature balloons while you're asleep. Right now, Kitsch is offering you 30% off your entire order at mykitsch.com/allusionist. That's right, 30% off anything and everything at mykitsch, spelt mykitsch.com/allusionist. That's mykitsch.com/allusionist for 30% off your order. Now back to Eurovision with Dean Vuletic. Who decides what is controversial?
The reference group of the Eurovision Song Contest. To simplify, I would say they basically decide if something is controversial, if it's going to be offensive to some political group, to some national group.
You can always find someone to be offended by something if you need justification.
You can, but this is, I think, why they wait for a response from interest groups, from the interested parties. Very interesting in this regard. Actually, I was thinking about this before meeting you today because I thought, how have there been songs in which, let's say, same-sex romances have been explicitly mentioned? And I think that Eurovision entries that have been seen as queer haven't been seen as queer because of the language of the songs, but more because of the performance. So if it's a drag performance, like that of Conchita Wurst, or even some earlier entries. There was one entry in 1961 which won Eurovision and is often considered as the first gay song in Eurovision, called Nous les Amoureux, We the Lovers, performed by Jean-Claude Pascal. And when you read the lyrics, they're ambiguous. You know, you don't, it's not clear that this is about the relationship between a man and a woman. It left that open, and a lot of people think that was deliberately done to make this a gay song. We don't have exact proof of that, but, you know, we're going by people's reactions and how people from the gay scene in French-speaking countries then interpreted the song. But otherwise, you know, you don't really get entries that, you know, will explicitly say, I'm a boy and I love a boy, or I'm a girl and I love a girl. You'll get a same-sex kiss to go along with the song or something like that, but nothing in the actual lyrics. And this has something to do with the fact that a lot of these entries have been in English, because in English, we don't have the same gendered language that we do, let's say, in romance languages, right? So, yeah, when it comes to queer entries in Eurovision, I think it's harder to have this message come across in the lyrics. And this is why perhaps a lot of these countries in which, you know, sexual minorities face prejudices, face legal obstacles, face harassment, in which they haven't been bold enough to say, no, we oppose this song because it's a queer song. It's harder to say when you just see the lyrics and the music. It's the performance that makes it queer.
I mean, I don't think it's unique to Eurovision that the existence of queer people shouldn't be counted as political.
Exactly, because we would like to think, you know, or hope that, you know, all of this gender and sexual diversity could be accepted in all societies, and that this shouldn't be a controversial matter, that it should be an issue of human rights. But when it comes to geopolitics, then you have, you know, nations being offended or threatened by each other, and that's what could really harm the reputation of Eurovision as the organizers see it. The organizers no longer have a problem with this social diversity. They see it as something that enriches the contest and as part of the values of the contest. But this is also because the organizers or the leadership of Eurovision come from countries in Europe, and especially the European Union, in which these are considered to be important values, important social values and human rights that should be upheld and promoted by the broadcasters that participate in Eurovision. But, you know, the Eurovision world is a world that stretches from Iceland to Azerbaijan. And just looking at those two countries, they have very different records when it comes to human rights, the human rights of sexual minorities, but also liberal democracy. Iceland is one of the most advanced liberal democracies in Europe, and Azerbaijan is one of its leading dictatorships.
Yeah. I was also wondering about lyrics that you wouldn't get because they weren't coded for you if you're not the person supposed to get them.
That's the other issue as well. And it also applies to political issues. Let's say Kosovo. It declared its independence in 2008. That independence was opposed by Serbia, which Kosovo had formerly been a part of. Yet, lo and behold, Serbia was about to hold Eurovision, stage Eurovision in Belgrade in 2008. And when Kosovo's independence had been recognized by many member states of the EU, as well as the United States, there were protests in Belgrade, which violently targeted some Western institutions in the city. And then there was a big debate over whether Belgrade could still host Eurovision, which was about to take place a few months later, considering the hostility that was shown towards the West in these protests. But Serbian television guaranteed that security would be heightened and that there would be no political messages in the contest itself, especially political messages concerning Serbia's claims to Kosovo. So the Serbian entry ended up being a folk-inspired song called Oro, and it mentioned Vidovdan, or St. Vitus's Day, which takes place on June 28th and has so much historical meaning for Serbs, including their defeat at the Battle of Kosovo on that date in 1389. So, you know, Vidovdan is only mentioned a few times in the song, but it's coded. This is a political message to those who understand Serbian and the meaning of this date in Serbian history. But it still managed to get past the censor in Eurovision, and it was not banned from the contest. Of course, because the Serbs could also argue, well, you know, it's a big national holiday anyway, it's a saint's day. You know, there are a lot of arguments that can be made to say that this is simply an important day in Serbian culture and has no political meaning. But for those of us who know Balkan history well, it could also easily be interpreted as a political message.
The Eurovision involves a lot of deliberating over what could be interpreted as a political message. For example, in 2015, Armenia had to retitle their song Don't Deny to Face the Shadow, lest Don't Deny was a reference to the centenary of the Armenian genocide. Another controversy happened in 2009 with Georgia's entry, a jaunty disco number about not letting negativity kill the group. The EBU rejected it before the semi-finals because they considered the song's title and refrain, "We don't wanna put in," to be breaching the rules that forbid political commentary in the songs. Why? Because put in Putin, as in Vladimir Putin? We don't wanna put in? I'm not sure a court of law would convict on that evidence, but Georgia had already voiced objections to the contest being held in Russia that year, citing contravention of human rights and international laws, and Georgia and Russia had been at war with each other in August 2008. Russia had already been the object of a lyric controversy in the 2007 contest. Ukraine's entry, written and performed in spectacular silver garb with the number 69 on the back by Verka Saduchka, was Dancing Lasha Tumbai. Verka said that Lasha Tumbai is a Mongolian phrase meaning milkshake or churned butter or whipped cream, but in the performance it sounded to some like she was singing not Lasha Tumbai, but Russia Goodbye. What do you think? The song came second. The EBU didn't rule against it, nor did they check their Mongolian dictionaries, because Lasha Tumbai is not Mongolian for any kind of churned dairy. In 2016, the EBU did overrule Russia's complaints that they were being targeted by Ukraine's entry 1944. What happened in 1944? Stalin forced all the Crimean Tatars to leave Crimea. Some 200,000 people were deported, the majority to Uzbekistan. Thousands died on their 3,000-kilometre journey, and many more died in the years following. According to Crimean Tatar numbers, as a result of the deportations, they lost 46% of their population. Russia said that figure was slander. According to the KGB, only 22% of Crimean Tatars died. 22% dead? That is not a Russia-exonerating number. Anyway, the Eurovision song was written in the wake of Russia's 2014 annexation of Crimea, which brought renewed persecution of Crimean Tatars. But the EBU ruled that the song did not contain political lyrics, and 1944 went on to win the contest for Ukraine. Even when the EBU doesn't mind it, the countries might. In the 1974 contest, Italy came second to Waterloo by ABBA, with Giulio Cinquetti performing a song called Sì, the Italian word for yes, which appears several times in the lyrics. It's a song about saying yes to love. So why did the Italian state broadcaster take such exception to it that they refused to run the live telecast of Eurovision? Well, the following month, Italy was to hold a referendum about whether to outlaw divorce, which had been legalised 3 years earlier. And all this singing of the word sì was considered potentially a subliminal message to influence Italian voters to vote sì to repeal the right to get divorced. Perhaps Eurovision should rethink the rule that all the entries must have lyrics, because look at all the trouble words cause. Again, just people want to sing and dance and have some nice sequins and stuff, and yet it's so incredibly loaded.
It is. It is in so many ways. And I think the language politics of Eurovision has always been one of the most loaded aspects of the contest, from the Italian origins to French domination, English domination, and this trend in recent years to embracing linguistic diversity once again. And I hope that this embrace of linguistic diversity in Eurovision will continue to grow. I think this is really the power of the contest, to teach Europeans, especially because, you know, Europeans are the core audience of this event, even though the contest has gone more global in recent years, but to teach Europeans more about the cultures that share this continent, to teach them more about the different languages that are spoken. I think very often to audiences outside of Europe, it seems that, you know, Europeans might seem to understand each other quite well, especially because we now have the European Union, in which we're economically and politically united, or much of the contest is. But I think there is still a lot for us to do to help Europeans to get to understand each other more and to learn about each other's cultures more. And I think that historically Eurovision has played a major role in this, as the biggest cultural event that unites Europeans, and that it really is. Even commissioners from the European Union will tell you that there are two big events that unite Europeans. One is Eurovision, the other is the Champions League soccer, in which we don't hear the different languages of Europeans. So Eurovision is very special in this regard, and my hope is that it will really re-embrace the linguistic diversity of the contest and be empowered by the fact that younger viewers as well are also attracted to the contest if it expresses this diversity and authenticity.
The Allusionist is sponsored by Squarespace, your one-stop shop for building and running your own beautifully designed website, the public face of your business or creative endeavors, or maybe both, like in my case. It's important to have an online space you can control, because we simply cannot trust the social platforms to not destroy our livelihoods or their own. Whereas Squarespace's vision for the future is for everybody to be an entrepreneur, they say. But the way I read this, isn't Squarespace saying, everybody come up with a Silicon Valley wheeze that you can sell for big bucks before everyone else realizes it's just a balloon full of farts? I think what they mean is they want people to be independently creative and expressive and to carve our own paths. I've been doing all that for more than 16 years now. Whew. And during that time, I've seen so many tech companies be born and die. But Squarespace has been going that whole time. And I sure do appreciate a company that is dependable and building itself to last so that we can keep our websites going strong for many years to come. Go to squarespace.com/allusionist for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, use the offer code allusionist to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. If you enjoy pop music analysis but like to keep it a bit more light and fun than dictators using the form to nice wash themselves, then check out our pod pal Switched On Pop, where musicologist Nate Sloan and songwriter Charlie Harding get stuck into what makes a hit, where a song fits in the culture, and what makes pop so irresistible. If I want to be cheered up and amused and left a little perkier than I was before, Switched On Pop is one of my go-to pods. You will find Switched On Pop in the pod places and at switchedonpop.com. And if you have any inclination and petty cash to help keep the Allusionist afloat, join the Allusiverse at theallusionist.org/donate. You get behind-the-scenes info about every episode. You get live streams with relaxing readings from reference books. Last week we had a really good time with a 1906 glossary of architectural terms. We'll never confuse our misericords and our misereres again, or our squinches and our squints. And you get to join your fellow Illusionauts in our companionable Discord community, where we'll watch this year's Eurovision final together, as we did last year. And another festivity has been suggested by Swaith, who says, I want there to be an official annual Illusiversary where Illusionauts plan ahead and meet up around the world on the same day to use randomly selected words in an email or text. I know this isn't much notice, but April 22nd is my birthday, so I decree it to be International Use a Randomly Selected Word from the Dictionary Day. You pick the word, you pick the dictionary, let me know what you find, or go rummage through the Allusionist back catalogue and randomly select one of my randomly selected words from the dictionary. Here's a fresh one for your use. Your randomly selected word from the dictionary today is urinant. Adjective, heraldry. Diving, head down. Noun, urinator, a diver. From the Latin urinari, to plunge. Try using urinant in an email today, or a text, or a conversation, or at your International User Randomly Selected Word from the Dictionary Day knees up. This episode was produced by me, Helen Zaltzman. The original music is by Martin Austwick of palebirdmusic.com. You heard from historian Dean Vuletic, author of the book Postwar Europe and the Eurovision Song Contest. He has a lot more to tell you about Eurovision, so check out his media appearances as well as the rest of his work at deanvuletic.com. Many thanks to Ewan Spence of ESC Insight, the podcast and website devoted to the Eurovision Song Contest all year round. Our ad partner is Multitude. If you have a product or thing that you would like me to talk about, sponsor a show. Contact Multitude at multitude.production/ads. Seek out Allusionist Show on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and you can hear or read every episode, find links to more information about the topics and people therein, see the full dictionary entries for the randomly selected words, and browse a lexicon of every word covered in the podcast, all at the show's forever home, theallusionist.org.